Today on the Rig Base, we're building a custom enclosure for our new lithium batteries and installing everything in our trailer. We're almost at the finish line for this project, so let's get this video started and wrap it up. In our last video, I successfully built the first of two 100 amp hour lithium iron phosphate batteries for our travel trailer. Before we can get out and start camping though, there's a little bit more work that needs to be done, so in this video, I'll wrap up this project by building a new battery enclosure, installing it and the batteries in our RV, and upgrading our trailer's converter to be able to charge lithium batteries. I can't wait to get out and start using these batteries in a real camping situation, and we actually have a trip scheduled for just a few days from now, so let's go ahead and dive in and get started. For our battery enclosure, we have a few different requirements that we set up at the beginning of this whole project that we're trying to satisfy. The first is, we need to fit it in the space available. The nose of our trailer slopes forward at a pretty sharp angle, so it gets really tight at this point between the cap and the propane tank cover. We can't have the battery box stick up too far, or it could hit here somewhere, especially if it has some sort of a hinged lid. So it would be nice to have the box sit down between the frame rails rather than on top of them so we can make the most of our available space. These are our specific limitations, but when you're building your battery box, you need to do some careful measuring and planning for your trailer so you know what you're working with. So we know what our maximum size is, but inside the box, we also have to have enough space for two batteries that we're eventually building, their BMSs, and all the cabling that's going to connect them together. I made kind of a big deal in the last videos about making these batteries tough and rugged, so it wouldn't make a lot of sense to have them flying around inside our battery box like Yahtzee dice or have the whole box rip off the trailer in a panic stop. So whatever we choose needs to be rugged, and we need to have a good plan for securing our batteries inside the box and for solidly mounting the entire box to the trailer. I also want this enclosure to be fully sealed so that we can protect against moisture and bugs and freakishly intelligent squirrels that like to get in things and chew on wires at night. Standard battery boxes for lead acid batteries usually have big air vents in them, but we don't need that for lithium batteries, so I won't be using any of those kind of boxes. With our battery and wiring sealed safely inside this container though, we'll need to think about how we connect what's inside the box to our trailer's wiring outside the box without undoing all of that weatherproofing. If cost were no object, I could be buying these lithium batteries off the shelf. I wouldn't, I'd still want to build them myself, but I could. But since we're trying to save money, it wouldn't make a lot of sense to have my battery enclosure cost more than the cost of our batteries, and some of these custom battery boxes out there can be hundreds of dollars. So instead, I'll look for something that I can adapt from some other purpose to be a good battery box for our project. And finally, maybe this one's just me, but I'd like it to look good when it's done. It's way better when somebody comes up in the campground and says, "Dude, what is that?" versus, "Dude, what is that?" I'll take slick over slap together any day. So given all that, I looked at a bunch of different options, and it turns out our biggest problem was our space. A real popular option is to use a trailer tongue toolbox, but even the smallest one we could find wouldn't fit on our trailer without hitting the nose cap when you open the lid. What I eventually did find is even better. This is a water and dust-proof hard case from Monoprice. Let's open the box without using a box cutter and take a look. This is a 20.3 liter model, but they have a few different sizes to choose from depending on the size of your batteries and your available space. It also comes with this really nice foam that we won't need, but I'll store that away for some future project. Based on the interior dimensions, this case might as well have been made for our batteries. I should be able to fit two batteries laid on their sides with the terminals facing outward and have just enough room for the BMSs and wiring. But there are a couple of things I'll need to take a look at a bit more. The lid has these molded in features that look like they'll hit the batteries when I close the lid, so I'll eventually need to remove those. And these rounded corners in the bottom of the case mean the battery may not be able to sit all the way down inside. So I'll do a quick test fit with the battery before I start modifying things, just to be sure. And not only does it fit perfectly front to back here, but it looks like there's going to be plenty of room for this BMS to fit. To make sure that I can fit two batteries in the case, I'll mark the end of the first battery with a little piece of masking tape and then just flip it around to make sure that the second one will fit. It will be tight, but I'll be able to use this area to route our cables and connect them to some terminals that mount on this end of the case. While I was doing this, I also noticed that the case has this air purge valve that sticks into the case and hits the batteries, so I'll need to trim off the end of that before we're done, but for now I'll just remove the E-clip and set that aside. The batteries are already fitting pretty nicely in the case, but I do need to keep them from moving around a bit more. We're okay in this direction because the battery already fits tightly here and here, but there's nothing to keep the battery from sliding from side to side when we go around corners or from moving up and down if the trailer goes over a bump. To secure the battery, we're actually going to use something we already have. You remember that polyethylene foam that our cells came packed in? Well, we're going to cut blocks of that to fit the case and the battery to hold everything in place and provide a little shock absorption. I'll start with the terminal end first. I marked the top edge of the battery cell cases, not the terminals, with a piece of masking tape and then measured and cut a piece of foam that dimension. I used a fillet knife rather than a utility knife so I get a nice clean cut with a single pass. I want this foam to press against the cell cases and not the terminals, so I'll mark and cut out relief notches in the foam to match those terminal locations. With this all trimmed, you can see how the foam will now put pressure on the cell cases, but not put any pressure on those terminals. That piece is done, so I'll put it in place and then slide the battery tightly to the right into position. Then I'll measure, cut, and trim another piece of foam to fit into that space to the left of the battery, making sure to cut it a little bit large so that it fits nice and tight. Next, we'll work on keeping the battery from moving vertically. If you remember from earlier, this lid has these molded-in brackets that need to be removed so the lid can close, so I'll make quick-ish work of those with a cutoff disc. Once they're all gone, the lid closes just like it should. I'll be using these surfaces for securing our battery, and to do that, I'll cut more foam blocks that lay on these edges of the battery and press against the lid when it's closed, and that'll hold the battery in place. Once everything's trimmed, I'll set them in place on the battery and apply a bead of hot glue to the top, and then close the lid and hold it in place for a few seconds. And like magic, when we open the lid again, the foam pieces are gone and they're attached perfectly in the right locations inside the lid. Now that we've finished securing our battery, it's time to move on to wiring. Our main battery positive and main C minus leads are inside the case, but we need a way to attach to them outside the case, so I'm going to use these through panel junction blocks that will let me connect our internal wires to this end on the inside of the case and connect our RV wiring to this end of the stud on the outside. We'll need to drill a couple of holes for these, so I'll tape up the area to be drilled and then lay out my measurements about 4 inches apart for the center line of those junction blocks, and I'll also mark the locations for their mounting screws. Generally, it's frowned upon to drill into lithium batteries, so I'll go ahead and remove the battery, and then I'll drill the center hole with a 1-inch hole saw, followed by mounting screw holes. After doing a little cleanup with a utility knife, I'm ready to test fit the terminals. And the first thing that I noticed was that the stud on the inside sticks a little too far into the case, so I'm going to disassemble them and trim about 3/8 of an inch off the inside end with a hacksaw. We just drilled big holes in the side of our case, but we want to keep things waterproof, so I'll apply a big bead of silicone sealant around the mounting flange before I push them into place with the black terminal on the left and the red terminal on the right. Then I'll secure them in place with some stainless socket head cap screws and nylon lock nuts, and then wipe off all that excess silicone. For our first battery connection, I need to connect this stud on the battery to this terminal. To do that, I'll use this 12-inch long 4-gauge battery cable. I'll start by removing the bolt from my main battery positive terminal and attach the cable at about the angle shown, making sure that that red balance lead is stacked on top of the cable's terminal end. And don't forget to tape up the other end of that cable for safety. With the battery back in the case, I can see there's going to be some interference here between the cable and that foam, so I'll cut a little relief notch in the foam block. And now when I put it back, the cable fits perfectly. There's a lot going on in a little space here, so you may need to experiment a little bit to get things right. If you mess up one of the foam blocks, remember you have lots of extra foam, so starting over is cheap. Also, when you're working in this confined space, you need to be extra careful not to short across any terminals. And speaking of shorting, the other thing I'm going to do is build a little insulating divider between the terminals and the studs. I'm going to use this Kydex that I had laying around, but you could just as easily use something like the center part of a Sterilite lid or some other piece of plastic. I'll trim my Kydex to the right shape a little bit at a time until it fits nicely down inside the case, and then I'm going to trim the bottom off. That way, when I cut a little slice into this foam block, I can slip the divider into that cut and have it be the right height. The last thing I need to do is just cut a couple of notches in the divider so that there's room for those battery cables to pass through. That's all I'm going to do for the wiring inside the case for now, because before I go any farther, I need to actually look at mounting the box to the trailer, and I'll need access to the bottom of the case for that. Before you start on any of these installation steps, be sure that your trailer is disconnected from any sort of shore power, and if you have a battery disconnect switch, turn that off now as well. I'll start by finally removing these old batteries. Good riddance, you heavy piles of junk. Our trailer has these two angle rails that the old battery boxes sit in, and this is a pretty common setup on most trailers. If we were to just mount the new box directly on top of these and bolt it down, the bottom would likely flex quite a bit, so you really couldn't tighten it down all the way. My propane line also runs across the top of these brackets, and I could reroute it, but I actually like the idea of it being on top of these brackets and being protected a little bit. So instead, I'm going to build some spacers that sit in these channels and raise the box up. That'll give me a solid mounting surface for the box, and it'll also give me a small gap that I can run my propane line through. I'll start by measuring the distance between these angles and then cut four pieces of 1¼-inch square tubing to length and drill a hole in each end. Then I'll use two of those spacers inside the battery box as a template for drilling matching holes in the bottom, but I'll push them as far as I can to the outside edges of the box so that the heads of the bolts don't hit our batteries. I'll measure the distance between those holes and give the spacers a quick coat of paint, and then I can head back out to the trailer. I'll transfer that width measurement to the stock battery angle brackets, and again, I'll use those spacers as a drilling template. I'll be using these 5/16 stainless carriage bolts to attach everything, and I want this shoulder to fit tightly in the hole in the battery tray, so I'll drill those holes with a 7/16-inch drill bit. I'll touch up the holes with paint and then stack two spacers per side, and then tap the bolts up into place using a hammer. If I measured and drilled correctly, this battery box will slip right into place. And it did. This is looking really good, and underneath we can see that the propane line is routing right where it should be. On the inside of the box, I'm going to use these stainless fender washers, but I cut one edge of them off with a hacksaw so that they won't interfere with that radius in the bottom of the case and deform or damage the case. The washers will help spread out the load around these mounting holes and keep the bolts from being able to pull through the bottom of the case. To keep it all waterproof, I'll add some more silicone sealant around the base of the bolts and then add the washers and some nylon lock nuts. I'm finally ready to install the battery for real, but now that we have these mounting bolts in place, that's interfering with the foam. So I'll just make a couple of last quick cuts and then drop our battery back into place. Now I can take the tape off that main battery positive cable and tighten it to the inside of the red terminal stud. Then I'll slide the battery to the right and repeat that process with the C- lead connecting it to the black terminal. The last step on this side of the battery is to carefully slip my insulator panel into place and make sure that it's not rubbing on any of the wires. Just like on the right hand side, I'll need to cut a couple of notches into this piece of foam for the mounting bolts, and then I can slide it into place. I haven't done anything yet with the charging system of our trailer, but since our battery disconnect is currently off, I'm going to go ahead and connect the positive and negative leads from the trailer to our battery pack, and then slide these protective boots in place. When I fire up the BMS app, I see the battery appear as it should, and when I tap into it, I can see the battery voltage and no current loads. If I switch the battery cutoff switch back to on, our in-command system will boot up and things like the radio will turn on in standby mode, and we can see just over an amp of current flowing out of the battery in about 16 watts. It's really interesting to see how all these little things in the background add up to steal power. But that's all discharging. Let's get into the charging and take a look at that converter. If you remember, our trailer came with a WIFCO 8945 converter, which is built specifically for lead acid batteries. Its charge behavior is not right for a lithium battery, but luckily WIFCO makes the 8950 L2 MBA, which is a drop-in replacement for our 8945, and is specifically built to support lithium iron phosphate batteries. We're about to dig into our trailer's high voltage wiring system, so just to be safe, I'm going to use a voltage detector to confirm that I'm detecting no voltage at the panel, and I'm going to visually confirm that we're not connected into shore power. Then I'll start by removing these two screws and removing this front cover. Down here, we have our stock converter that we'll be replacing with our 8950. Replacing these is actually kind of a piece of cake because every wire on the old converter has an identical and corresponding wire on the new converter. So we just need to find and disconnect the wires from the stock converter one by one, and then when we install the new converter, we'll put the corresponding wires from the new converter back in those locations. We'll start with these large white and pink wires. These are connected to these two lugs on the DC fuse panel. They wrap around behind the panel, so to make it easier to get to them, press the latch at the bottom of the panel with the screwdriver and the whole thing should pop free. Now I'll just loosen those two lugs and remove the pink and the white leads. The next two wires are these white and green leads that come up from the converter through this hole, with the green wire connecting to this ground terminal bar and the white wire connecting to this neutral terminal bar. Loosen the screws on both of those wires and then remove them from the terminal bars. The last wire is this black lead with this Y pigtail, and if I trace that inside the box, I see that it connects to the bottom circuit of this dual circuit breaker. With that breaker out, you can see that second wire here, so I'll loosen this terminal and then remove the wire from the breaker. On the other end of that Y is this wire nut, so I'll remove that and then I'll just slide the breaker back into its slot a little bit to keep it out of the way. All the wires are disconnected, so I'm ready to remove the old converter, and I'll do that by unscrewing the two screws in the front of its plastic base, and then I'll just slide the converter right out, followed by all the wires. To install the new converter, we'll reverse that process. I'll feed the wires back up through the openings, pink and white on the right, black, white, and green on the left, and then slide the converter back into position so I can get some slack in the wires. I'll wrap the white and red wires around the back of the fuse panel and give them a good bend so that they'll be able to slide into those battery lugs. And then I'll plug the white one into the neg minus terminal and the red wire into the plus VCC terminal, and then tighten them both down. Then I'll slip the top edge of that fuse panel back into the notch on the top back of the case and then press the bottom back until it locks into place. Next, I'll grab that Y connector and slip it into our open breaker terminal and tighten it down. Then I'll find that pigtail that comes off the Y connector and the black wire that the old pigtail was connected to. Then I'll twist them together, add a wire nut, and finish them off with some electrical tape. Now I can slide the breaker back in place and press to fully seat it. Next, I'll slip the white lead into place on that neutral bar, tighten the lug, and then tuck that wire out of the way. And then insert the green wire into the ground bar and tighten its lug. With the wires all connected, I'll reinstall those two screws in the base of the converter to hold it in place. And then I can put the panel back in place and tighten the two cover screws. Now I can plug back into shore power, double check that I have power flowing to my panel, and then turn my breakers back on one at a time. That fan sound means that our converter is seeing the AC power and is powering up. We also have power back in our trailer, and so both of those things are really good signs. And when I go turn on that battery cutoff switch, I should see my battery charging for the first time. We can definitely see charge current flowing into the battery, and it's not as high as I would expect. I'm not sure whether that's something you'd be concerned about, but I'm not too surprised that the converter wouldn't run at full capacity all the time. Nevertheless, that is something I'm going to keep an eye on. But wait a second, we're not done, are we? Because we talked about wanting to have 200 amp hours, and I just finished building a 100 amp hour battery. Well, originally my thought was that we'd build one battery, maybe take it out camping and see how it went before we built the second battery, but this went together so well that I'm going to go ahead and just plow forward and build that second battery and get it installed. While I was building the battery case, I went ahead and started the process of balancing the cells for the second battery, so I'm actually ready to start assembling that second battery now, and I just need to replicate that process I used when building the first one. And thanks to the magic of editing, here is the second battery mounted inside the battery box. This case is definitely a snug fit for these two batteries, with not a lot of extra room for the cabling, but in the end, everything fit really nicely. The first battery went in with its terminals facing to the right, and the second battery went in with its terminals facing to the left, and the bases of the two batteries facing each other. That meant that I needed to route cables from the main battery positive and main battery negative from the second battery all the way over to this side to the junction blocks. What I ended up using was this 2-foot battery cable that was left over from my original batteries to connect the main battery positive to the positive junction block, and it was exactly the length that I needed. For the C-minus lead, I used a 12-inch cable to connect it to the negative junction block and connected them together using a stainless steel bolt. To keep the cable where I want, I held everything in place with these adhesive-backed ratcheting quick clips. I saw this spot where the cable is near this bracket and thought that it could get chafed over time, so I also added this heavy-duty heat shrink tubing for some extra protection. To hold the second battery in place, I also added 2 more foam blocks up inside the lid, and now this cable can route right up into this gap when the lid's closed. The last thing that I'll do is add some heat shrink tubing to this connection to protect everything, and then we'll be ready to hit the road camping. And with that, we're essentially done, but let's step back and take a look at the finished product. This thing looks incredible. This looks like a legitimate power pack. There might as well be nuclear launch codes inside that thing or something. And look at how sleek and compact that is. If you back up and check this out, you get a great perspective on its small size relative to the trailer. And looking at it from the side, you can see that it just barely peeks up above the frame rails. From a safety perspective, because it's sunken down inside the rails, that's going to be extra well protected against random impacts. And that security strap that you're seeing there is something I'm going to do a separate video about, because it's not technically required to get up and running with lithium batteries, and it's something that applies to just about any battery setup. For now, that wraps up the construction part of this project, and at least on paper, we've accomplished everything that we set out to do. We have 200 amp hours of usable lithium power, we have them installed in the trailer, and we've upgraded our RV's charging system to be able to handle the new batteries. We also saved about half off the cost of buying them off the shelf, and I got to learn a bunch along the way. But playing with your batteries in your driveway can only tell you so much, so we'll definitely be heading out on a real trip and putting them through their paces. And I'm sure that we're gonna learn very quickly what I didn't know or all the things I didn't think of. Assuming we don't have a catastrophic failure, I'll be back soon to let you know how it all went. Actually, if we do have a catastrophic failure, I'll definitely be back to let you know how it went and let you know what we learned. In the meantime, if you learned something from this video or you have a question, let me know in the comments below. Either way, I hope you're inspired to get out there and start your battery build project. If you're on the fence, go for it. If someone's doubting you and whether you can really do this, show them these videos and then confidently tell them, yeah, you can. Thanks for watching. See you soon.